an end. We pray for those, not just here in New Zealand, but all over the world, who struggle to make ends meet. Too many, including children, go to bed at night hungry, with no idea where the next meal will come from. Lord, we pray for your provision in these circumstances. We pray for those suffering from mental illness. More and more people worldwide are suffering from the effects of depression and anxiety. Lord, we pray for the restoration and healing of their minds. We pray for broken families. Please be with each family member that is suffering. We pray for each individual whose family has been torn apart by divorce, abuse, abandonment, drugs, alcohol, death, and any other circumstance. We pray that you heal them, provide them with comfort only you can supply. I now invite you to add your prayers where you are.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And now it's time for questions of the day. First one. What did, or for the younger generation, do you like best about school? So I'll allow some time for you to discuss it amongst yourselves. Maybe there's going to be, some people are going to be walking around the path of nostalgia. So I'll allow some time for you guys just to chat about it. And get in groups of three or four. All right. All right. Anybody have any comments or any feedback on what they like best about school? All right. To the right here. What was that?
The last day of school.
The last day of school. Never would have guessed. Yep. Lunchtime. We all got to eat. Brilliant. Anybody else? Oh, brilliant. Yes?
I also like the library.
Oh, the library, yes. I know it's a time for learning. I know Lorraine also just shared that she enjoyed the learning aspect of school. And I mean, that's what schools are all about.
I've got 12A, 2B,
the
report.
Wow, that's impressive. Can't be that one. Yes? Oh, brilliant. Okay. I hopefully didn't burn down the lab on that.
No, but I had somebody who made me some gas, I forget what it was, and the first experiment, I stood with my head out the window, and somebody came and put the gas jar and put it upside down under my nose, and I was just inhaled all this ammonia gas.
Oh, my. Oh, my goodness. All right. Yes. Okay, that's a good one. Okay, shall we move on to our second question? How can we tell as believers whether or not we're growing? Sh- shall I leave you to reflect on that, and I'll just share a thought and whether this is me growing as a believer or not. I've learned to accept when you pray for something and the answer is no, right? I've learned that it's no for a reason. My prayers wasn't answered about 4 years ago, and that has led me to this path so that I'm speaking in front of you good people today. And if I look back now, when I prayed for something and the answer was no, it was the right answer from God. So that's something that I've learned to accept. So when I pray and the answer is no, I actually thank the Lord instead of being angry, which we do tend to feel at times. And it's human nature, right? But it's just something that I thought I should share, and which is maybe relevant to some of you as well. Any other thoughts? Or shall we? Yes. 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 Anybody else? Yes. 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 Correct. That could even be relevant in this war in Gaza. If people learn to forgive, you'd ask yourself, would there still be a war? Yeah, sometimes adversity is a blessing, I think. Yeah, that's something that I've learned as well. Anybody else? All right. And now we'll have our reading from Hebrews 5 to 11 to 6 to 3. And if we could all read together. We have a lot to say about this, but it is hard to make it clear to you. That's because you are no longer trying to understand. By this time, you should be teachers, but in fact, you need someone to teach you all over again. You need even the simple truths of God's word. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk is still a baby. A person does not want to learn about living. Solid food is for those who are grown up. They have trained themselves to tell the difference between good and evil. It shows they have grown up. So let us move beyond the simple teachings about Christ. Let us grow up as believers. Let us start from all over again. They taught us that we need to turn away from those things. Taught us that we must have faith in God. These basic teachings taught us about different ways of becoming human. They taught us about placing hands and blessing them. They taught us that people will rise from the dead. They taught us that God will judge everyone. And they taught us that He desires. Hear what the Spirit is saying to us. So we'll now be having our speaker, Donna. Donna, if you want to come up and say a prayer for you. Lord, dear Lord, bestow your blessing on Donna this morning. Anoint her words with wisdom and grace, that she might reveal more of your truth and love to all who hear. Amen.
Morena whanau. Good morning, family. When you were growing up, did you have a place in your home where you marked your height? I remember we had it on the inside of a door jamb and we used to try to see how fast we were growing. And I often felt as if it took too long to grow even an inch or so. But it was always exciting to see just how much growing my sisters and I had done over the years. But what if, instead of growing up, one of us had stopped growing or had grown down? I'm sure it would have had our parents scheduling an immediate doctor's appointment to find out what was wrong. Growth is normal and a cause for joy. Shrinkage would have been bizarre and a cause for alarm. Now, many of the Christians in our reading this morning had grown down in their Christian walk, not up. In verse 12, it says that they had come to need milk again, not solid food. Imagine a teenager who suddenly stops eating regular food and goes back to milk and Watties baby tins. Instead of being able to teach others, they now need someone to teach them the basics of Christian life all over again. And the author wants to talk to them about Jesus being this high priest after the order of Melchizedek, but he fears that it will be over their heads. A bit like trying to teach algebra to preschoolers, it's highly unlikely that they are able to learn or even understand it. So before he plunges into this subject, he issues the strong warning that runs right through from chapter 5, verse 11 to 6, 20. In the text, he sings, "Grow up, people!" I'm saying that to myself too, don't worry. Believers are called to move beyond the basics of the Christian faith and grow up in Christ. Have you ever been in a situation where an adult was acting like a child, throwing a temper tantrum or not dealing with a frustrating situation in a mature way? I don't know about you, but I am tempted to tell them to grow up and act their age. But that's what this passage is saying to the Hebrew Christians. It's not an easy passage. It's full of challenge, both for the original readers and us today. Now, I've had the occasional conversation about the way some people come to church. They ask for forgiveness and in the confession, and they receive absolution, and then they go out and carry on as if everything was back to normal again, doing the same thing as they did before. And I'll admit, when I was a teenager, that was pretty much how I interpreted the liturgy. I'm sorry, God, thanks for that. Off I go. I was forgiven, the slate was clean, but I really hadn't understood or learnt that I needed to change and grow and not do those things that caused me to lose my connection with God. My growth was stunted because my focus wasn't on my spiritual life, but on my selfish desires. So how do we stay on track? How do we grow? And this passage, we're given five lessons on Christian growth. One, it is possible to be a Christian, but to be slow to grow. If there is spiritual life, there will be spiritual growth of some sort, but growth rates vary. Some people become Christians and instantly drop the sins that have plagued their lives for years, and they never fall back. Others struggle to get rid of those sins for decades. For example, there was a man who was saved in his early 40s. He was a nightclub entertainer, addicted to alcohol, tobacco, and drugs. And he instantly dropped all of those habits and began to follow Christ. He became a pastor and flourished in his calling. But then there are others who have struggled with those same habits for years after making a profession of faith. They make a break from them, but then they keep falling back to them. And verse 11 hits us with the fact that they have become dull of hearing. They didn't used to be that way, but they have developed this spiritual illness. Now, the word dull here is used only in this verse, 6:12, and in Hebrews 5. Only two times this word dull is used in the New Testament, and it implies that they are sluggish and slow. It's most likely referring to someone being sick and therefore lacking energy. So this word then has the idea of spiritual laziness and lethargy. When there is an opportunity to get into God's word, this is the person who says, "Nah, let's see what's on TV." And when there's occasion to go and hear the word taught, the response is, "I'm tired. I think I'll just stay home and go to bed early." Verse 11 tells us that teaching God's word is a two-way matter. There is the knowledge and ability of the teacher to explain things clearly and in an interesting manner. But also there is the receptivity of the listeners. It's significant that the best teacher who has ever lived used to urge his audience like this. Anyone who has ears to hear, let them hear. Take care how you listen, for whoever has, to them more shall be given. And whoever does not have, even what they think they have will be taken away from them. Luke 8:8-18. If Jesus is the preacher and the message isn't coming through, guess who's at fault? When we aren't listening, teaching is difficult. What do we need, then, to be able to listen well? Motivation. Motivation is the key to learning. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied." So hunger and thirst are strong motivators. When you're hungry or thirsty, there is only one thing on your mind: to satisfy the craving, the need for food and drink. If you are driven by hunger or thirst for righteousness, you will be satisfied. Matthew 5:6. If you think, "Yeah, okay, whatever," not only will you not grow, you won't even know what you're missing. There's another message in verse 1. There is no neutral in the Christian life. Either you are growing or you are shrinking. Which is it for you right now? We fool ourselves into thinking that we're just treading water, but the strong current of the world, the flesh and the devil, carries us backwards if we're not striving to move ahead. Let me put it another way. If we're not making time daily to spend in God's word and in prayer, we're not growing. We're shrinking. It's like going from eating prime Angus beef back to milk and puree. That stuff is great for babies, but it's not going to sustain a growing teenager or adult for long. 2. Christian growth means moving on to deeper levels of understanding. These verses teach about the significance of Jesus being a high priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. But it's just too much to understand. It's like trying to get a young person to read Shakespeare, especially written in the Old English. They can't even recognise the letters of the alphabet. In terms of their years as believers, they should have been capable, but they actually need to go back to spiritual kindergarten. Verse 12 says, "In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again." The last phrase is parallel to the elementary teachings of Christ and refers to the basic truths about the Christian faith. Who Jesus Christ is, what he came to do, how we enter into a relationship with him, and how we live the Christian life, etc., etc. But beyond these basics, there is much in Scripture that is deep and nourishing. Someone has said that the Bible is like an ocean, deep enough to drown an elephant, sorry elephants, but shallow enough at the shore for a toddler to play. If you want to see how spiritually dull you really are, try reading the Westminster Shorter Catechism, which was written in 1647. Keep in mind that all children in that era were required to completely memorise before they could be confirmed and join the church. And I'm sure you all know the first question and answer. What is the chief end of man? Or what is the reason we exist? And the answer, of course, is man's chief purpose is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Now, there's a lifetime of practical content in that one short answer. But would you know the answer to all the questions? The Shorter Catechism has 107 questions and answers. Our Anglican Catechism only has 71. I dare to ask you, though, if you know what they are. When was the last time you thought about who we are, why we exist, and what we believe? Back to Hebrews. When it says that they should have been teachers, it doesn't mean that this was written for a select group of leaders in the church. It was meant for every Christian who has been a believer for a few years. They and we should be knowledgeable enough in the teachings of Scripture to instruct a newer believer. Now, not everyone is gifted as a teacher for the whole church, as we see in James 3, verse 1, and Ephesians 4, 11 to 12. But we all should know enough to present the gospel, to teach the basics about God, man, salvation, and the Christian life. If we can't do that, either we are relatively new believers, or we're one of the older believers that this section of Scripture confronts. Grow up! We live in an era of dumbed down Christianity, where we have an aversion to sound doctrine. The word of our day, even among some evangelicals, is doctrine is deadhead knowledge, and that just leads to arguments and division. So be careful not to get into doctrine too far. But the fact is, every believer has doctrines. They may be sound doctrines in line with Scripture, or they might be a little screwy and not quite consistent with what Scripture says. Theology is simply the process of synthesizing and harmonizing the teachings of the whole Bible on major subjects that it discusses. So if you are a Christian, you can't avoid being a theologian. The question is, are you growing to be sound in your theology, or are you shallow, mixed up, and unbiblical in your theology? 3. Christian growth is directly related to obedience to the truth that we have already learned. Verse 13 says, "For everyone who partakes only of milk is not accustomed to the word of righteousness." This describes spiritually mature as those who eat solid food, who because of practice have their senses trained to discern good and evil. using the phrase word of righteousness for the scriptures, which are designed to produce God's righteousness in those who believe and obey. It may be referring to the doctrine of imputed righteousness, what an awful word, imputed, as taught in Genesis 15:6 and repeated by Paul in Romans 3 and 4. But also those who are counted righteous by faith in Christ will also progress in practical righteousness, learning what is pleasing to the Lord. Ephesians 5 verse 10. You may think that righteousness and good and evil are obvious, but that is not necessarily so. These things need to be learned through practice and training. Behaviour needs to be discerned according to God's word. Our culture bombards us with immoral behaviour as if it were neutral or even desirable. Political correctness influences us, not wanting to offend anyone. We allow ourselves to waver and compromise in our beliefs. We watch the same TV shows and movies as the rest of the world does. We read our Bibles only occasionally. Is it any wonder that we are growing backwards? The point is, Bible doctrine is not just to fill our heads or help us defend some theological system. It is always intended to make you and me a more godly person. So when studying the Bible or theology, always study with an aim to obedience and godly living. We've seen that it is possible to be a Christian, but be slow to grow. Also, Christian growth means moving on to deeper levels of understanding, and it is directly related to obedience to the truth that we have learned. Next, Christian growth requires laying a foundation of doctrine and then building on it. In 6:1, we are challenged to leave the elementary teaching about Christ and press on to maturity, not laying again a foundation. And then it mentions six things that compromise foundational elementary teaching. By leaving these things, he's not suggesting that they are no longer important and should be left behind, but rather he is saying that once you lay a proper foundation, don't go back and dig it up again and again. Move on, building your life on that foundation. There are differing views about how to interpret these six things, and some argue that they refer solely to Jewish Old Testament issues, but others say that they relate to the basics of Christianity, and still others mix these categories. They've been arranged in three pairs. Repentance from dead works and faith towards God. The phrase dead works occurs only here in chapter 9, verse 14, which talks about the blood of Jesus cleansing our consciences from dead works to serve the living God. All spiritual works of the unbeliever are dead works because they either originate from souls that are spiritually dead, or they result in final spiritual death if the person trusts in them for eternal life. In a Jewish setting, dead works refer to external and self-righteous compliance with the requirements of the law. If the Jew boasted in his keeping the ceremonial law, or even in his outward compliance with the Ten Commandments, and thought that those works would gain him eternal life, he was in for a rude awakening. Repentance from dead works and faith towards God are at the heart of the gospel. The two are inseparable. You cannot trust Christ as Saviour without turning from sin. The person who turns from sin trusts Christ as his only hope. As to why Hebrews says faith towards God rather than Christ, Christ came to reconnect humanity with spontaneous trustfulness towards God. Our departure from this trust led to our condition of fallenness and alienation. And it is through the mediation of the Son that we return to the Father. Instruction about washing hands and laying on of hands. And these phrases can be difficult to understand. Some say that instructions about washing, which is the Greek word baptismon, refers to teaching about the various ceremonial cleansings in the Old Testament, along with the various baptisms in the new. For example, the baptism of John, the baptism of Christ, the baptism of the apostles, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The laying on of hands would then refer to the conferring of spiritual blessings or gifts early in one's Christian experience. Charles Simeon, in Expository Outlines of the Whole Bible, has a different view. He says that these two phrases are parenthetical and explanatory of the first two. By washings, he understands the various cleansings of the law, which pointed ahead to cleansing from sin and dead works through repentance. And by laying on of hands, he understands the laying of hands on the head of the sacrificial victim before it was offered, pointing ahead to the believer's faith in Christ as his sacrifice for sin. I'll let you consider both of those views. And the third coupling, the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. These are basic teachings of the gospel, that everyone will be raised either to eternal life or to eternal judgment. John 5:24-29. As Paul taught in 1 Corinthians 15, if the dead are not raised, then Christ is not raised, and our entire faith is in vain. But the point is, as a believer, we must learn basic Bible doctrines and then build upon the foundation. Studying one of the classic catechisms or our statements of faith will help us to lay a foundation, and then we go deeper. Read some books on doctrine and theology. Finally, Christian growth does not happen automatically. It takes deliberate effort along with God's enabling. Practice refers to a habit that is formed by deliberate effort. Trained is an athletic term that Paul uses in 1 Timothy 4:7, where he tells Timothy to discipline himself for the purpose of godliness. No athlete excels by casually dabbling in his sport. He's got a goal and he works at it for hours every day, denying himself other pleasures that may detract from his goal. For the Christian, the goal is godliness and holiness. We should cut everything out of our lives that detracts from godliness and do everything that we can to move towards godliness. In 6:3, the author says, we will move on to the deeper teaching, if God permits. Leon Morris says, we should take the words not simply as a pious nod, and the plan he was suggesting was impossible. The command, press on to maturity, is a passage with the hint of being born by God towards maturity. It's the same word that Peter uses in 2 Peter 1:21 when he says that writers of Scripture were moved by the Holy Spirit. This word referred to a ship at sea being directed by the wind in its sails. It means that while spiritual growth is our responsibility and requires our effort, beneath the whole process is God's power. As Paul finally balances it, work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Philippians 2:12-13. I realise that spiritual growth is more difficult to measure than a child's physical growth, but we can be sure that we're not growing if our spiritual life is running on autopilot. We are not growing if we are haphazard and inconsistent about Bible reading, prayer, and community. We are not growing if we are not making a deliberate effort to discipline our life for godliness. If we're not growing up, we're shrinking. Today, we are being told, grow up! Amen.
Thank you very much for that message, Donna. Just to remind us Christians that, you know, for me, sometimes you're watching that television program that's so interesting and you at that voice at the back of your head is saying, you know, you're watching this television program, but maybe I should be spending time soaking up the word. So it's just something to think about. We will now have our second session of songs performed by the group. Thank you.
just reflecting on the things we have just sung to the Lord, we come to a time of confession. Happy are those whose sins are forgiven, whose wrongs are pardoned. I will confess my sins to the Lord. I will not conceal my wrongdoings. So just as we remain standing, just an opportunity for us to reflect on those things which we want to bring to God in confession right now. Remembering that God forgives and heals us. And so we pray. We need your healing, merciful God. Give us true repentance. Some sins are plain to us, some escape us, some we cannot face. Forgive us. Set us free to hear your word to us. Set us free to serve you. In Christ you are forgiven. Forgive others. Forgive yourself. Go free. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Now to the great Thanksgiving. I invite you to make the responses. Let's think about the words as we say them. Christ is risen. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to God. It is the joy of our salvation, God of the universe, to give you thanks through Jesus Christ. You said, let there be light. There was light. Your light shines on in our darkness. You, the earth, has brought forth life in all its forms. You have created us to hear your word, to do your will, and to be fulfilled in your love. It is right to thank you. You sent your Son to be for us the way we need to follow and the truth we need to know. You sent your Son to give his life, to release us from our sin. His cross has taken our guilt away. Send your Holy Spirit to strengthen, to guide, to warn, and to revive your church. Therefore, with all your witnesses who surround us on every side, count us as heaven's stars. We praise you for our creation and our calling with loving and with joyful. Holy and just, glory and goodness come from you. Glory to you, Most High and Great. I invite you to sit as we continue in our prayers. Blessed are you, Most Holy God. We remember your Son as he washed his disciples' feet. I'm among you, Jesus said, as one who serves. Then on that night, before he died, he took bread, gave you thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this to remember me. After supper, he took the cup. He gave you thanks. He gave it to them and said, drink this. It is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you, shed for all. Do this to remember me. Therefore, God of the past and present, with this bread and wine we remember your Son. We thank you for his coming in glory, and in him we give ourselves to you. Through your Holy Spirit, may we who receive Christ's body be indeed the body of Christ. May we who share his cup draw strength from the one true vine. Called to follow Christ, help us to reconcile and unite. Called to suffer, give us hope in our calling. And so we pray together. Our Father in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not bring us to the test, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Christ's body was broken for us on the cross. His blood was shed for our forgiveness. So come, God's people, come to receive Christ's heavenly provision. A very warm invitation for anyone who's visiting us today to come to receive the bread and the wine. If you would prefer to have a blessing in that place, or if you'd like both, if you could just place your hand on your heart and we will pray with you. There will be others to pray with you also. So come, God's people.
Yeah. changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see, and all I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000. Lord, every morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord.
Prayers, thanksgiving after communion, I invite you to make the responses. Blessed be God who has called us together.
Praise God who makes us people.
Blessed be God who has forgiven our sin.
Praise God who gives us hope and freedom.
Blessed be God whose word is proclaimed. Therefore we offer you all that we are and all that we shall become. So the peace of God, which passes all understanding, with your hearts and your minds, and the love and love of God, and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Would you please be seated?
Before I get stuck into the notices, I'd just like to say special thanks to the worship group, music group this morning. Hearing you guys perform was music to my ears. I'm sure I speak for everybody. Thank you. So, again, a special welcome to visitors. Just a reminder that there is pre-ministry available after the service at the front table. And then there is a book launch next week. Church of the Saviour's Writers Group have published their third book, and limited copies will be available next week. And there's a quote which says, "My help comes from the Lord." There will be a lunch. There will be a launch of this book over morning tea. We do invite family or anyone you think might be interested in joining us on this special occasion. And then on Wednesday morning at 10 a.m., there's a healing service. There's flyers in the foyer to invite friends and family. And then there's a hair-raising hat party I haven't heard of that for a long time. In fact, I haven't heard of that at all. It's called Illuminate 2023. And there's a quote, Jesus' loves break through the darkness. And that is on Tuesday, the 31st of October, at the Blockhouse Bay Baptist Church. And again, there's a flyer in the foyer with those details. And then congratulations to, to Blanche and Donald on their wedding last week. All right, so now we will have our last song. So if you could. Goodness of God.
Need to tell you this, but you probably don't really need to know, but the musicians will appreciate that we're going to be singing in G major. And if I was just playing this, I could just change and transpose into whatever key I thought you'd be comfortable with, but I've got guitarists and a flautist, and it's not that easy. So it's going to be in G major, which is quite low, so if it's too low, sing an octave higher. For you musicians, help those non-musicians out, please. But it's God's goodness, so it's worth singing about. Amen.
I love you.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
We go in the name of Christ.